Thank you very much, Steve. Let me start by saying what a pleasure it is to be here this evening and to be sharing the program with my good friend and occasional colleague, Sig Hecker. I think our task is to try to frame the issues that we're contending with and basically provide a platform on which you can then make comments and ask questions. So I think what is envisioned is a conversation, not just two lectures, which is good from my point of view. I came back to the problems of North Korea in the spring of 2009, having been away from them for almost 10 years after I left Seoul as ambassador. I found certain differences that struck me as being rather fundamental. First, the strategic context within which the United States and our allies and partners were trying to deal with the threat of North Korea had shifted dramatically in just a little less than 10 years. When I was working on the North Korean issue in the 90s, including when I was in South Korea's ambassador, it was seen and we treated it as a largely U.S. issue, one that we were principally in charge of settling or trying to settle. When I came back in 2009, I found an entirely different regional context. First of all, in the 90s, I would go for months at a time and never really think all that much about what China's views were on the North Korean issue, because China was not actively engaged in the diplomacy by choice. Secondly, when I came back in 2009, I discovered quite a different South Korea from the one that I had known in the 1990s. Different in many ways, and we can get into that in the question and answer period, but different particularly in that it was then under the administration of a South Korean administration, which was of a very different point of view on the issue of how to deal with North Korea than had been the Kim Dae-jung administration, which was in power when I was there. Thirdly, Japan, which had been a principal partner of the United States in trying to cope with the problems of North Korea in the 1990s. By 2009, Japan's role was different. I'm not quite sure how to describe what it was, but it was certainly different than it had been in the 90s. In part, I think, because Japan had become much more preoccupied with its own domestic condition. And its expressed interest on the North Korean issue, while they obviously were still concerned about nukes and missiles, their expressed interest was the fate of the Japanese abductees who had been taken by the North Koreans 30 years ago. So also, all of these countries had, together with the United States, formed a process to negotiate with the North Koreans, a process that took shape in the early 2000s. That process was referred to as the six-party process. So it was a very different context in which we were operating, far different from the era of the early 1990s, when basically the U.S. very self-assuredly stepped forward and basically tried to deal with the threat of North Korea. Some things were, however, the same. And it's in those same, in that sense, that we were able to begin putting together a program for dealing with North Korea back in the 2000s. Let me say just a word about interests and how each of those countries perceive North Korea and its interests. First of all five of us, including Russia, have a common interest in seeing that North Korea does not become a permanent nuclear weapon state. I might say that so far we've not been very successful in securing that interest. But in addition to that common interest, which ties us together, we have specific national interests which are different. From the Chinese point of view, for example, they don't want to have a nuclear North Korea, but neither do they want to see North Korea collapse. And I think that their animus toward either outcome is probably about equal. For the Chinese, North Korea plays a vital role of a buffer state between China and and South Korea, the U.S. ally, military ally in South Korea. I think the Chinese nightmare is that someday they will wake up and the Koreas will have reunified and still have a military relationship with the United States. From the Chinese perspective, I think that would be a sharp negative shift in the correlation of forces in Northeast Asia. And they not only talk about that outcome as being something that they will do almost anything to avoid, but their policies express that. Japan, as I said, has an expressed interest in the fate of the abductees. That's not to say that they're not actively concerned about the missile program, the nuclear program. They are. But they, as I said, have taken a somewhat less assertive role in the regional diplomacy than they were taking back in the 1990s, when they were one of our key partners in developing the framework for dealing with North Korea under the agreed framework of Geneva. South Korea's role is perhaps the most the changes in South Korea's role are perhaps the most interesting of all. Because as China's preeminence in the position in the region has risen, so has South Korea's, at least from the perspective of the United States. Because South Korea has now become an even more important ally and partner of the United States within the region than they were back in the 1990s, in part because of their own success. They're a flourishing democracy, a flourishing economy, and a growing power within the region and globally. So that from the U.S. point of view, we look now to South Korea as a bit of an offset, if you will, to the rise of China. Not that the two are equated in any way, but we are very conscious of South Korean interests, including South Korean interests with regard to North Korea. The result of that is that from U.S. policy perspective, South Korea now has more sway, if you will, in the formulation of a U.S.-South Korean approach to North Korea than was the case in the 1990s. Not that we rode roughshod over South Korea's interest in the 1990s, but I can assure you that having been involved in both periods, we give much more importance now to what South Korea wants and what South Korea believes than we had in the 1990s. So for the U.S., as we look at this melange of interests and activities, this is an even more complicated geopolitical issue than it was when we were dealing with it under the agreed framework. And we can get into that in some detail if you're so inclined. The threat from North Korea has remained to some extent the same. I think it is twofold. One, the nuclear threat, a strategic threat, which has clearly gotten somewhat worse in that, in contrast to the enriched or the fissile material that they had in the 90s, which we estimated would be sufficient for one or two nuclear devices. After they broke out of the agreed framework, they were able to create more or produce more fissile material, and we now estimate that they have enough for from 8 to 12 devices. That's assuming that they have not produced any fissile material from the technology that they gave Sig Hecker a glimpse of when he was there back in 2010, that being uranium enrichment. What they've had before that was all plutonium-based, but they, we believe, have made significant progress in uranium enrichment, and that they've actually enriched to a level of they could potentially be producing more fissile material and have greater capacity to produce nuclear weapons. But in some ways, the greatest threat, I think, from North Korea within the region is instability. This is, in all ways, basically a failed state in the heart of what is demonstrably the most important, the most vigorous geopolitical region of the world. And its neighbors are very concerned that that instability could bust loose at any time. That concern has, of course, been exacerbated over the last few months with the death of Kim Jong-il and the coming to power, or at least coming into office, of Kim Jong-un. I am not among the observers who believe that Kim Jong-un has any great degree of authority over decision-making in North Korea, but clearly he has a role, and he is the public face of the regime and seems to be settling in a fairly vigorous way. So I think it's not just the nuclear program and the missile program that we have to be concerned about. It is the longer-term problem of a sort of perpetually unstable or potentially unstable North Korea and the threats that it poses within this region. Our options, quite frankly, and I'm going to wind up and let Sig take over and we'll get to the question period, but our options, quite frankly, on how to deal with this are to say the least, not good. We basically have the possibility of changing in some fashion the regime in North Korea. And believe me, if I could see a way to do that that didn't put several million South Koreans at risk, I would be sorely tempted, because this is a despicable regime. There's nothing you can say good about the government or the regime in North Korea. But in addition to whatever they might have in the nuclear field, they have metropolitan Seoul with 10 to 20 million South Koreans there, hostage to their conventional forces, rockets and artillery pieces. And our military, at least when I was there, estimated that they could put several hundred artillery shells a minute into metropolitan Seoul. The damage that that would do to South Korea, of course, was horrendous. The damage that it would do to the global economy these days, in these days of interconnectedness, is also horrendous. So you have to deal with these guys very gingerly. And if I could see a route to regime change that could be brought about surgically and quickly, I would say it's worth looking at, worth exploring. The other option, of course, is to try to engage with them, to change their perception of their interests, their self-interest. And that's fundamentally what we've been trying to do over the last almost now 20 years. The problem with that is that they're very difficult to engage with. And I think there is a basic inability on the part of democracies to sustain the kind of policy that would be necessary to make engagement feasible on an extended basis. You know, de Tocqueville was right. He said that exercise of foreign policy is one of the weaknesses of democratic systems because, to paraphrase him, foreign policy success requires the steady application of attention and force over a protracted period of time. In our system of government, where our perception of interests and the world changes on a fairly frequent basis, at least with our electoral cycle, that's very hard for us to do. And North Korea, unfortunately, has become a very contentious issue within our domestic body politic. So it's very difficult to sustain that level of commitment, that level of attention that would be required to engage with them over a long period of time. And yet, I come down saying that we really do not have an alternative. It may not be good, but it's the only mechanism that I can foresee that we could pursue to try to bring gradually some change in the environment of the Korean Peninsula. I think that there is probably a need to reduce to some extent our focus on the nuclear and missile issues, which have constituted the heart of our agenda with North Korea over the last 20 years. I think we have to begin to address the longer term issues of instability. And as long as North Korea feels that it has basically leverage and clout with us, because of our fixation on the nuclear issue and the missile program, I think they become even more difficult to deal with. But I must say, I'm very glad not to be any longer the special representative for North Korea policy. And I'm very frank to admit that while We made a little progress. I think that progress has proved not to be very lasting because the North Koreans have now taken us back to where we were in effect in the summer of 2009 after they tested a missile and another nuclear device. So I look forward to exploring some of these questions more thoroughly in the question and answer period. See?